Thanks for coming out. I know I've seen a lot of you guys that are actually doing this diet now. So a couple of years ago, this was really controversial. Now it's kind of partially controversial, and it's good to see that we made some progress here. So I'm going to talk about meat and a little bit of other stuff. So I've got some conflicts. I've written this book. I'm the CEO of MeatRx, which we just heard, and I eat a lot of meat, so I'm heavily biased in favor of this. So what is a carnivore diet? Since I wrote the book, I've taken the liberty to be able to define it the way I like to define it. So I consider it a nutrient-dense, animal-sourced foods with the complete elimination or limitation of plants to the degree necessary to provide health. So you see, I've got this or limitation. So that doesn't mean everyone has to be strictly 100% meat, salt, and water like some people do. And many people find that to be helpful. But I do think that we have to kind of figure out, you know, what the goal is, and the goal is health. And so we take the dogma out of this. You know, many people will just do fatty red meats. You know, when you don't have carbohydrates, you need energy. Fat seems to be a good source of that. Protein's not a particularly good energy source. Water, plus or minus salt, plus or minus organs. There's some people that feel that organs are essential. I don't necessarily feel that way, but that's a bit of a controversy. And there's a lot of people that are kind of in this sort of carnivore-ish space, hyper-carnivore, keto-carnivore. I want to call it meato, kind of like keto. Meat-based keto, carnivore, adjacent, carnivorous, whatever. And I think whatever works for you is what works, and I think we just need to sort of realize that. This is my anecdote. I'm 53. This was right before my 53rd birthday. I don't take drugs. I don't take hormone replacement. I've got, like, some records in sports, and coronary artery calcium scan of zero, which I think is an important thing to point out. You know, the outside's fine, but, you know, it seems to be working okay on the inside as well. And more importantly, we got thousands more. In fact, if you're in the room, you've been on a carnivore diet and been helped, put your hand up. I know we've got, you know, like I said, this is kind of funny. You know, you'd have said this 3 or 4 years ago, and this was like crazy. So thousands and thousands and thousands of these people are now coming out of the closet, so to speak. We have a new coming out of the closet saying, "I actually eat meat." And they're getting healthier. And we're collecting more and more of those every single day, which is really, really fun stuff. So why does it seem to help? I mean, I'm not going to say I know for sure, but I've got some speculation. You know, one thing is, and we heard about satiety. I mean, appetite regulation, we see it with a ketogenic diet. Satiety is very important, whether it results in a calorie deficit or not, whether there's a metabolic advantage. You know, David Ludwig might argue about that. Certainly, we know protein seems to be an advantageous macronutrient for not putting on fat. Craving and addiction extinction, I think this is something that is very unique. And our last speaker just talked about getting rid of sweet. And I think that's a very important part of this. And whether you do it for the rest of your life or for a finite period of time, it's very important to do that. And uniquely, I think when we're getting high quality nutrition, it's easier to deal physiologically with those cravings. And then the psychological part can be addressed. There's a thermic effect of protein. We get rid of junk. I mean, it's hard to make carnivore junk food. I mean, there's people trying, but it's really hard. And then there's a lot of thought around gut permeability. I know there's a lot of thought on microbiome, which I think there's a lot of, you know, early sort of conclusions about the microbiome, which I don't think we can make yet. But certainly, I do see gut permeability seem to be an issue that helps. And then obviously, when you have glucose, it's very stable. And resolution of hyperinsulinemia on a carnivore diet seems to help with that, just like many people see on a ketogenic diet. So those things all seem to be favorable for why it seems to work. Is it a miracle? You know, based on the strength of the evidence available, and there's not much, so we can't make those claims. You know, it will not make you live longer, or we can't make those claims. It's not going to save you from a disease. It might make you healthier, and there's a lot of people it has. It will definitely cure you of veganism. It's the only thing I can say definitively. So nutrition science, I put quotes around that, and I know Dr. Westman's done a lot of the research, but there is a lot of problems with nutrition science. I think we need to be realistic about that, about what we can say and what we can't say. I think short-term stuff, we can say a lot. I think long-term stuff about the effects of nutrition on mortality, disease, based on epidemiologic studies, which is the vast majority of what we do, you know, in nutrition science, has some big holes in it. And so one is the FFQ. I know we've heard about the food frequency questionnaire. There was a validation study that I looked at recently. I just read it, and I was my jaw hit the floor when I read the conclusions about this study. But they administered Well, what they actually did is they actually had people weigh and measure their food, which is considered the gold standard on seeing what people eat outside of a metabolic ward. So they actually measured and weighed everything. And then they had them repeat 30 days later a food frequency questionnaire, and they looked at how well those things correlated. In only 9 out of 25 times did they even get it half right, which is like, that's not really good odds there. 16 out of 25 times, they failed to even achieve half the time that they got what they measured and what they actually thought they ate. 82% of the time, they overestimated vegetable intake, and 56% of the time, they overestimated fruit intake. The conclusion of the study was, good enough for epidemiology, press on, which I was like, holy cow. So, you know, if you look at it, if you're going on a plane, they said, hey, 9 out of 25 times, you're going to get you, there's a 50% chance you might make it to your destination. You'd be like, you know, or you go to have surgery, and 9 out of 25 times, you get the right operation 50% of the time. This is what we have out there. So this is good enough for, it's like good enough for government work, good enough for epidemiology. So I'm not impressed. So they do it, you know, they do these studies. They might administer an FFQ once or twice over a decade or two decades. And this is the data we're getting. And then they come back with a relative risk of 1.2, which is basically nothing. And then you do the math on there, and you do the long equation, and the answer is garbage. And so I think we can't rely on this stuff. And so this is a guy, John Anitis. He's out of Stanford, a very well-respected public health guy. He said, we just wasted billions of dollars doing epidemiology. Let's stop doing that stuff. Let's actually do real science. Gordon Guyatt, you guys like to hear about evidence-based medicine. He's the guy that actually invented that term in 1991 in a single-author paper. I interviewed him recently. He basically says the nutritional guidelines, I don't even know we have them, you know, because it's not serving people very well, because there's no evidence that really shows that. And I know we're all proponents of low-carb diets here, but I mean, when we're talking about, am I going to live longer? Am I going to avoid heart disease? These things are a little bit, you know, things we don't need to focus on. So essential requirements for nutrition, this is biochemistry. This is not controversial. We need essential fats, essential amino acids, vitamins, and then minerals. And some people put micronutrients there, but I think minerals covers that pretty well. This is what we clearly have to have to survive as human beings. What we don't need, and this is a controversial start, do we need plants? I haven't had them 3 years. I'm not dead. So if we say there's an essential plant, I challenge you to point out, tell me which one is it. You know, which one is it? Because, and how many do you need? Where do they grow? Do they grow everywhere in the world? Remember, humans started, you know, arguably, or Homo sapiens started arguably in Africa, and we made it through Southern Europe, Asia, North America, down to South America, and then finally the Pacific Islands. And so what plant was growing everywhere all year long, in all climates and all seasons? And if you can find something, and maybe grass, I don't know, and are they always available? So when we say, you know, there's superfoods, there's these plants we have to survive, I can't think of one. You know, if somebody tells me blueberries are necessary for me to survive, I'm gonna say, where do you get blueberries in January in Alaska or, you know, Northern Canada? They're just not there. So fiber is another one. You know, we've got to have fiber. Fiber is essential. If we don't have fiber, our colon's going to fall out. The fiber-loving bacteria are going to revolt. You know, but that just doesn't happen. And so, you know, one of the thoughts, you know, the latest belief that fiber is necessary so we can produce these things called short-chain fatty acids. One in particular I'd like to point out is butyrate, because it seems to help with the colonocytes, their health. And there's this... you know, for you guys who are on ketogenic diets, you've probably heard of beta-hydroxybutyrate. It sounds a lot like butyrate, right? So hydroxyl radical, an OH molecule, different, and that's a reversal reaction that actually can happen pretty easily. So if you have circulating ketones and those colonocytes have a blood supply, they're likely getting the ketones they need, or the beta-hydroxybutyrate, or the butyrate. You can also make butyrate from amino. You can also make short-chain fatty acids from amino acids. Butter has butyric acid. So all these, there's other sources to get there. And again, there is no award at the end of life for the largest or most frequent bowel movements. There was a study that I think was Ann Peary did in like 2012, and she looked at 2,000 colonoscopies, and she saw that the people that had the most fiber, the most bowel movements, had the highest incidence of diverticulosis, which is these little pouches that come off your colon, which later get irritated or infected and end up with diverticulitis. And so there's pretty much evidence out there that shows that maybe we don't need to be just killing ourselves with so much fiber. Scurvy, no one's gotten scurvy. I mean, this is one of these things that, I mean, that should be the end of the story. No one gets it, but we have to kind of defend that. We've got the old belief in the Limeys, the English sailors that used to sail across the ocean these long 3-4 month voyages, and they would get scurvy. And the reason was if they were eating dried meat and hardtack, which is basically they were on a high carb diet eating dried meat. So if you go on an all beef jerky diet, you might get scurvy, but no one's recommending that. This is the other thing is some people say, well, you're getting vitamin C from eating organs like liver, or pancreas or some of the other ones that have that. But I've done calculations on the animals because there's people that say, you got to eat nose to tail. If you were to eat a whole animal, the animal would have to have like 8 livers for you to get the RDA of vitamin C. So there has to be some other things going on. So there's compensatory things going on where no one's getting scurvy. And I'm not going to go into all the details on that. And I've talked about it many times. Again, predicting the future. Again, using these nutritional studies. So, can anybody tell me the randomized control trial of any diet where they put people long enough to get hard endpoint clinical outcomes? That would be 20 years in a metabolic ward using twins, controlling every variable, so you can say definitively what causes heart disease, cancer, and so on and so forth. So we don't have that. So we end up using this lower quality evidence, this nutritional epidemiology, some animal studies, or biomarker outcomes. We can short term, we can see whose cholesterol goes up, whose cholesterol goes down. Those things are really just not good for making these determinations. So I don't even attempt to go there. I don't know. That's why I said I have no idea if this diet's going to make anyone live longer or shorter, because I just don't think it's possible to find that out. Are plants good for us? And again, it depends on the plants. If we go outside and walk outside and start randomly eating plants out there, we're all going to get sick and some of us will die from that. So there's certain plants that we've managed to cultivate. Again, they don't contain anything unique that we can't get from an animal product. And even if we say we want to get vitamin C, you could eat, extra liver if you wanted to do that. But the same argument goes for meat. The people that are vegan say, well, we can get everything we need from plants. We just got to balance all the essential amino acids and so on and so forth. There's one thing called duckweed, which apparently does have B12, they've discovered, but duckweed doesn't just grow everywhere. Just like when we go across the world, we can find animals everywhere. And this is one of the reasons. Think about it. How do we get across the world and get all over the planet as human beings? And it's through animal nutrition, because animals are everywhere and we've eaten every one of them. We talk about who's the apex predator. Name me another animal that can eat whales and cows and sheep and everything that exists, and we're the only ones that have done that. Hormesis is another argument people use for plants. So one of the thoughts is, if you guys aren't familiar with the concept of hormesis, it's we take a small amount of toxin and it builds up our endogenous defense system. It upregulates our antioxidants and so on and so forth. But guess what? Hormesis can occur a lot of ways. You don't have to eat the broccoli to have hormesis. You can exercise. You can do some fasting. You can expose yourself to hot or cold. All of those things are very powerful hormetic stressors. So you, like I said, you don't have to inhale the tailpipe exhaust to get your hormetic effect. And I'm not necessarily comparing broccoli to tailpipes, but the comparison holds up. All right, this is a different topic here. This is the and more stuff. And I think we have a healthcare system which, in my view, is actually sick. I think the healthcare system itself is sick. And I don't know that it's fixable, quite honestly. And so I've come recently to call the healthcare system the disease management industry, because that's really what we're doing. I mean, all we're doing is putting bandage. When I was replacing people's knees and shoulders and hips, I mean, literally, I'm putting a high-dollar Band-Aid on somebody. And I used to think I would replace someone's knee, and then, they'd be happy, oh, Dr. Baker, my knee felt better. And then a year later, they come back for their other knee. And I felt good because, hey, they want me to fix their other knee, too. But really, I should have been, what could I have done to prevent that person from needing a knee replacement in the first place? And if we do that the way we should, we would see that $3.7 trillion a year we spend on healthcare go down tremendously. And I think that's what we need to do. So the disease management industry is heavily dependent on pharmacy procedures and increasingly more and more expensive technology. And we're all excited about this technology, but guess what? The more technology we have, the more sick people we have. The more tests we can do, the more, you know, our grandparents didn't have all these tests and they were healthier than we were. And so why with all these tests, all this technology, are we still just as sick as we ever were or even more? And it's really a top-down type of thing. And we have lots and lots of repeated customers, but they're not particularly happy. And so I like to talk about the health creation business. That's what we're what I'm trying to do. And other people out here, this whole thing, I think, is about that. So it's lifestyle, it's nutrition, it's exercise, sleep, stress, light. We've heard all this before, and it doesn't change. The basics are the basics. It can be very inexpensive. The problem is there's not a lot of profit in that. But it tends to be bottom up. It's you know, it's people that are frustrated. We're tired of going to the doctor and having our pills shuffled around. You know, let's try this one, let's try this jug. And what we see is, instead of lots of unhappy customers, I see people who are now passionate, some people call them zealots, but passionate advocates for a way of life, and they want to share their experience, and they want to use that to help other people. And I think that's a wonderful thing. You know, what we have also in the disease management industry, and I look at this, we have literally an army of paramedical personnel. We've got lab techs, radiology techs, nursing assistants, pharmacy techs, scrub techs, pathology, and the list goes on and on and on. You know, and it's a massive physical infrastructure. I mean, these hospital systems, they cost hundreds of millions of dollars to build these things. And what we're doing here, online, digitally, we've got armies of part-time trained, motivated, everyday people, and it's a cell phone. I mean, you think about the cost savings and what you can do with something like, you know, what MeterX and some of these other things that are out there, the Sapien movement and what Eric's doing. This is, I think, the way forward. I think this is the way we have to do that. And so that's where I'm excited about. And this is where, you know, whatever the next couple of decades I spend in quote-unquote helping people is going to be. All right, that I think is all. I think we have questions later. Thank you, guys.